Welcome. My name is Dr. Ehsan Garajadaghi. I am the Chief Clinical Officer at Beginnings Treatment Centers, and I have been asked to shed some light on some particular problems that parents may have with their children who are addicted to substances and to drugs. For this episode, what I have chosen are 10 mistakes that families usually make when it comes to addressing addiction. So I'm going to go through those with some possible explanations and solutions and almost antidotes, if you will, or remedies to those mistakes. The first mistake I label as addiction does not affect me, where families may just look at addiction in that light, that they cannot fathom that addiction would affect their family and their family members. They see that as something that cannot permeate, cannot intrude, if you will, into their lifestyle, or it does not belong to them. It belongs to somebody else, some other families. Other people can be affected by it, but us. Everybody else, maybe even my neighbors or co-workers or partners or other distant family members may be affected by addiction. They have somebody addicted in their family, but we keep our distance, or it just cannot affect us. It cannot hurt us, it cannot get to us. But that's really a myth. I mean, addiction does not depend on any particular, characteristic of that are related to, let's say, genes or family dynamics or ethnicity or socioeconomic status or gender or wealth or geography. Addiction is all over the place. Any family, any person in the world, regardless of those characteristics, can be affected by addiction. So there is really no guarantee and no sure protection against addiction. Some people, unfortunately, some families still believe that addiction cannot get to them and cannot affect them based on those particular characteristics that I mentioned. As said before, family may say, well, we are... in our social status, in our social standing, the group of people that we hang out with, or the education that we have, or the specific geographic location that we live in could be protected against addiction. But that's rarely the case, and that can become a barrier to even addressing the problem, detecting the problem. At times, this mindset that addiction cannot affect a certain family can keep a family and the family members that are related to the person who is struggling with addiction in denial and away from the solution. That's one of the biggest mistakes that are being done. The second mistake I label as there is a short-term solution. A lot of times we see that where families with the problem that is affecting their family member, their loved one, think of an addiction treatment as something that can be done in a very brief period of time, such as they hope maybe to get their family member to a physician, to a doctor, to a psychologist, to a psychiatrist, to even a therapist, and hope that a few sessions would just get rid of the problem. At times, they hope they take a little bit informed and they would like to have a little bit of a long-term solution. But again, still, even if they have been informed that addiction requires a little bit of a longer treatment, they still are hoping that perhaps their family member can go to a treatment center, to a rehab for a few weeks, a few months, and then completely get rid of that addiction. And that is a huge mistake as well. Generally, we know that addiction is a long-term problem. It has probably taken many years for the addict to actually develop certain addictive patterns. And also, it will take many years with rigorous, basically weekly treatment, weekly, if not daily, treatment of the problem for them to be able to overcome their addiction. The third mistake I label as having a tough conversation with that family member and or negotiating a certain deal with that family member may solve the problem. And that is a mistake as well. A lot of times, again, family members, if they are suspecting that my child may be addicted, or they're maybe thinking about it, or they may be under the influence, they may think that, you know, I'm going to sit down with my child and have a tough conversation. I'm going to come to an agreement, some kind of a negotiation with that child in order to get rid of the problem, as if it is a willpower problem that can be negotiated, or as if it is a simple rational decision that needs to be hashed out. But oftentimes that's not the case. A simple tough conversation or an attempt at negotiating a certain deal, if you will, or a certain agreement with the person who is addicted backfires. It doesn't lead anywhere. Many times it leads to what we call enabling and further codependency of the addict on the family, as well as the family on the addict. Then the fourth mistake is what I call as throwing tons of money at it. Again, it's some in the past, especially, as we have seen throughout the history of addiction treatment, we have seen many, many family members who have sent their loved ones to rehab centers, treatment centers that have cost a lot of money. They have thought, if I find the most expensive treatment center with the best reputation out there, no matter how much it costs, I could get rid of the problem by getting my child in front of a group of specialists at the best rate and highest quality. However, again, money itself by itself doesn't solve the problem. It's not how much we spend during a very brief period of time. It's more to that than meets the eye. And that's why I'm bringing this up. We will talk about more effective ways of treatment that goes way beyond just how much money we throw at it. Fifth mistake is ignoring the problem. A lot of times, some family members, they have some suspicion, they sense something, they understand that something is out of order, out of the ordinary. They notice their family members struggling, they see the signs of addiction, but they just somehow choose to ignore the problem. They choose to postpone the necessary discussion that needs to be had with that family member. They choose to at times attribute that particular difficulty they see with their family member to extraneous circumstantial issues and problems in their lives. And then the sixth problem is actually delaying the treatment. So beyond just ignoring, and attributing to other circumstantial causes, they may know that there is a problem, but then just kind of delay it for various reasons. Let's say there is a pending event coming up, a wedding is coming up, a graduation is coming up, a family is moving, or there is a promotion, whatever the reason may be, and the family members decide it's better to wait for that event to pass rather than addressing the problem. But at times, these types of postponement or delays can actually lead to either making the problem worse or causing further rift and even major life problems, issues such as legal problems, DUIs, or injuries, or even, unfortunately, at times, even an accidental overdose of a drug. Just because the treatment and help was not provided immediately. The seventh problem and mistake I see families make are choosing the first rehab they come across, not interviewing, not really digging deeper into everything about that rehab. You know, the best option to choose a rehab really would entail some kind of a rigorous examination of their staff, of their facilities, of their programs, of the quality of service that they provide, of the competence of the clinicians and operational staff that are running that place, of the outcome studies or past success stories that they have had, actually interacting with some of the staff that is working there, establishing a good rapport and connection with decision makers at that rehab centers. So that cannot be done by just choosing the first rehab that comes across, the first website that the person goes to and studies. So some people really need to put some time into examining, discovering, understanding what that rehab is about, making the connections, taking the family member to this place, and actually continuing that type of a communication, conversation, and connection with the rehab center. The eighth mistake that I see families are making is seeing the problem as separate from family dynamics that are currently present. So more or less looking at the addict or at the person, at the child that is struggling with addiction as an oddball, as someone who basically is an exception to the norm, exception to the rule, as someone that really doesn't belong to the family, someone who is doing this thing out of nowhere without any reason and without any understanding of how the entire upbringing, entire culture, entire community, entire family dynamics that are intertwined with maintaining that addiction, maintaining those choices in this person that is struggling with addiction. So seeing the child and the problem as separate from the system of the family, of the environment, of the community, of the peers that the person is interacting with is a big mistake. We have to really take a different approach, a more what we call a systemic approach, an integrative approach to seeing the entire family, the entire community, the entire lifestyle that this person is engaged in as part of both the problem and the solution. So we have to take a look at what else is contributing to this, the maintenance of this problem. And that leads me to the ninth mistake, which is at a lot of times families actually don't get involved in the treatment. They send off their child to a treatment center, to a rehab center, thinking that that's their problem and they need to solve it. It has nothing to do with us. But that again is a big mistake because that's not going to lead to any recovery. In reality, the entire family needs to be involved in the treatment one way or another. And it's not to say that every family member also has to attend a recovery group or rehab or become part of a daily treatment or weekly treatment. But completely washing one's hand off of the family member and sending them off and hoping that the problem will go away, it will not work. So ultimately, families need to get involved, remain involved in the recovery of their loved one. That can take various forms and shapes, for instance, by doing family therapy, by going to some kind of support groups to learn ways of not exacerbating the problem, not enabling the family member, not creating more codependency. So self-education, if you will, self-improvement, even reading up and educating oneself about the problem of addiction. Sometimes doing conjoint therapy with the family member that is involved. And various other forms of, again, being involved in the treatment. And lastly, the 10th mistake that I see a lot of family members make, if they haven't already made all these other mistakes that we have mentioned, and or if they have attempted at trying to negotiate or work out some kind of a treatment or deal with a family member, and it has not led to any successful outcome. The last mistake that I see families make, which is devastating, is disowning their child. You know, at times it comes out of necessity. And I've worked with many, many families who have simply, after many years of attempting to solve the problem and not having a good, successful outcome, they have just decided to completely cut off their family member from themselves, and basically outright proclaiming that they're disowning the child from everything, from an emotional support, from financial support, from physical proximity or presence. and hoping that that will finally solve the problem. And again, that is a big mistake that is proven to show devastating results as well, because just getting rid of a family member really it doesn't provide a long-term relief and solution for that problem in the first place, because ultimately now there is an injured attachment, injured connection with a family member. There's injury in that connection, because when you have disowned the child, then we have to deal with the aftermath of that disowning, meaning with the trauma, with the loss, with the grief that comes with that process. So now we have created a new problem rather than an actual solution. This was a summary of 10 mistakes that I have seen family members make in regards to, especially parents make in regards to addressing addiction with their children. Stay tuned for another video and information about more possible solutions. And by the way, I encourage you to leave a comment if you like this video, or even if you didn't like it, if you have any comment, leave that comment for us. We would appreciate that. We welcome your opinions, your feedback to improve the material that we're providing. And if you are thinking of any other topic or concept or problem area that you would like to get some advice or information about, please leave that comment. We would be more than happy to provide that information for you. Thank you.